This video is sponsored by Cuts. Wind and solar are becoming more popular by the minute, and there's enough energy coming from the sun and the wind to power the world. There's a problem. Because of their intermittency, we need vast amounts of energy storage, and we can't just install wind and solar farms wherever we want. But what if I told you there was a virtually limitless, clean, reliable, and sustainable source of renewable energy that's available 24/7 all over the world, and that it could provide all the energy we'll ever need for the next 2 million years? We're talking about geothermal energy, and it's beneath your feet as we speak. So why aren't we building these power plants that are geothermal based everywhere? I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. Geothermal power is one of the most promising sources of renewable energy, and it's also one of the most underutilized. It works by capturing heat from the Earth's core and transporting it to the surface where we can use it for heating or convert it into electricity. In the latter case, geothermal power plants work similarly to thermal power plants in that they use hot pressurized steam to power a steam turbine that drives a generator. However, instead of burning fossil fuels to generate hot steam, we use heat from the Earth's core. So how much geothermal energy is there? This heat is in part a remnant from the Earth's original forming, but a significant portion of it comes from nuclear fission reactions of decaying radioactive elements present in the Earth's core. Because of all that internal energy, the Earth's solid core is at a scorching 10,800 degrees Fahrenheit, around 6,000 degrees Celsius, almost as hot as the surface of the sun. That heat is conducted to the outer layers, creating a geothermal temperature gradient that extends to the Earth's crust, where we can tap into this heat. Now, for different reasons we're not going to get into, we can't really drill any deeper than about 5.5 miles, 10 kilometers, or a tenth of the crust maximum thickness. At that depth, the Earth's temperature gradient, or geothermal gradient, has an average temperature of about 450 degrees Fahrenheit. So that's not crazy hot, but it is about pizza oven hot. And there's approximately 1.3 times 10 to the 27th joules of thermal energy available. That's 13 followed by 26 zeros. To understand just how mind-bogglingly large that number is, consider that the global energy consumption in 2021 was almost 6.1 times 10 to the 20 joules. So geothermal is, for all practical purposes, an inexhaustible resource. One we've been using for thousands of years as a source of heat, and since 1904 to produce electricity, when Prince Piero Ginori Conti, an Italian businessman and politician, invented the geothermal power plant in Lardarello, Tuscany. Geothermal's underlying importance is that, unlike solar and wind, it doesn't suffer from intermittency. As I pointed out in previous videos, this intermittency means we'll need massive amounts of grid energy storage worldwide, over 20,000 times what we have now, to replace fossil fuels with wind and solar. Additionally, solar is only a viable option in places that get a lot of sunshine, and wind speeds are only sufficient to power turbines in certain areas around the world. In contrast, geothermal power plants can provide clean, carbon-free energy in a reliable and predictable way 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, making it one of the few available options to replace gas and diesel turbines for base load power generation. I'm going to try to travel to bring you more on-site coverage in our future videos, which is why I'm so excited about our sponsor this week. Cuts is the premium clothing brand that brings excellent style, comfort, and quality together with fantastic fit and functionality. Cuts is made for this sport of business with an amazing line of work leisure clothes, perfect as we get back out into the world, back to work, school, or travel. I like a blend of t-shirts and polos, and their fabrics are super soft, and with ready thread anti-wrinkle technology, you can grab them and go with minimal maintenance. I love that about them. Their Pika Pro fabric is stretchy, buttery soft, and retains its shape and color better than any shirt I've ever owned. My latest purchase was their Always On joggers that I can't get enough of, and now that it's fall, I got my eye on some Cuts pullover crews and classic hoodies. Ditch the fast fashion brands. Their low quality won't last, and they're horrible for the environment. And save time and hassle shopping at malls. Check out Cuts at cuts.team/tubit and use code TUBIT to save 15% today. Huge thanks to Cuts and you for supporting the show. Here are a couple more fun facts about geothermal energy that make it an awesome energy source. Number one, geothermal power plants have a very small footprint. Compared to most other energy sources, geothermal power plants also make better use of land. They only need to take up about 0.1 acres, around 400 square meters per gigawatt hour per year of installed capacity. That's only half a tennis court per gigawatt hour compared to hydro's massive 27 acres or 109,000 square meters, coal's 0.9 acres, solar power's 0.8, and wind farms at 0.33 acres. In fact, geothermal is number two in terms of footprint, only to nuclear at 0.95 acres. Two, they can leverage the oil industry's know-how and equipment. Building a geothermal power plant is very similar to drilling an oil or gas production well. This is a huge incentive for big oil companies to invest in this technology. As fossil fuels run out or are eventually phased out, because it would let them repurpose millions of dollars worth of equipment and infrastructure while providing a steady source of income to replace their previous oil revenues. What's more, this will also mean that oil field industry workers and specialized engineers won't be left without a job when we replace fossil fuels. Three, we can use it to repurpose wastewater. California houses the largest geothermal power complex in the world, the geysers, which produces around 900 megawatts of electricity. The plant uses wastewater from several nearby towns to recharge the wells and keep them producing energy. Finally, as I said before, geothermal is present below the surface of our entire planet. So we all could, in theory, set up a geothermal power plant anywhere we need one. Now, if you've made it this far in the video, you're probably just as excited about geothermal as I am. And you're probably pretty puzzled. Why aren't we building these power plants everywhere if they're so great? To be fair, we have built a good number of geothermal power plants around the world, but these are nowhere near as many as we need or could build. The total installed geothermal power capacity worldwide reached only 15.6 gigawatts in 2021, which is roughly 0.6% of our current power consumption. That's why I say this is one of the most underutilized sources of energy. If you're thinking, there must be something wrong with geothermal then, well, there is. But to understand what it is, we'll have to go a bit deeper into how geothermal energy production actually works. In essence, we have geothermal for two main applications, as a direct source of heat or to transform that heat into electricity. When we talk about direct use, we mean direct transferring heat from the earth to residential, commercial, industrial, and recreational buildings through district heating, geothermal heat pumps, and other technology. I made a video about geothermal heat pumps, and my good friend Matt Farrell from Undecided is also installing one for his net zero home build. I suggest you check out those videos when you finish watching this one, links in the description. Geothermal power plants, on the other hand, are what we use to produce electricity from the Earth's heat. As I said in the beginning of this video, all of those power plants use steam-powered turbines to power electricity generators. The rest of the system comes in several variations, the most common of which are dry steam, flash, and binary geothermal power plants. The first technology was the one originally invented by Piero Ginori in Italy. This setup feeds hot water vapor and steam extracted from hot underground permeable reservoirs directly into the turbine. The steam is then cooled, condensed, and pumped back into the reservoir as liquid water through an injection well. Dry steam power plants are not all that common, but some of the units in the geysers in California do run on dry steam generators. Contrary to dry steam, flash geothermal power plants extract high-pressure, high-temperature liquid water from the production into a flash tank where it then evaporates. This produces high-pressure steam that is then fed into the turbine. Finally, we have binary cycle power plants that use one fluid, usually liquid water, to extract heat from the permeable reservoir and transfer that heat through a heat exchanger to a working fluid, usually an organic compound with a much lower boiling point, which readily evaporates, producing the steam that powers the turbine. Binary plants are great because they can work at much lower temperatures and therefore at much shallower depths than dry steam and flash power plants. All these technologies are mature and have already been deployed at commercial scale worldwide, but as you can probably guess, they have several drawbacks. The biggest problem holding us back from worldwide geothermal deployment is finding suitable sites for their construction. The basic requirements for suitable sites include heat, fluids, steam and water, and most importantly, fractured, permeable rock. We can always find geothermal heat if we drill deep enough, and we can almost always find suitable sources of water to pump into the reservoir, including wastewater from nearby towns. But permeability of the rock is a challenge. There are only a few accessible places on Earth where traditional geothermal is feasible. So it would seem that the vast amount of that energy below our feet is out of reach. For example, in the US, the country's eastern coast is practically devoid of geothermal potential with current technology. The second big obstacle is cost. The process of exploration, drilling into the ground, building a power plant, and generating power is very expensive. These costs drive geothermal average levelized cost of electricity generation, or LCOE, in the range of around 4 cents to 14 cents per kilowatt hour, making it more expensive than onshore wind and utility scale solar. Last but definitely not least, there's a proven connection between pumping water through injection wells at geothermal sites and low magnitude seismic activity in the region. While these tremors are typically no stronger than 3 on the Richter scale, it's definitely something that scares the wits out of the local residents, and that generates pushback from local communities. So there you have it. We finally uncovered the answer to why aren't geothermal plants everywhere. With our current technology, we can't just build them anywhere. They're crazy expensive to build. They don't represent an attractive option for investors, and it scares locals. Does that mean it's the end for geothermal energy? Of course not. I wouldn't be covering this if it was. There are at least two or three promising new technologies that could potentially change the game for geothermal energy, one of which we've already seen hit commercial scale. They both aim to solve geothermal's biggest problem, the need for fractured, permeable rock. The first technology is called Enhanced Geothermal Systems, or EGS. An EGS is a geothermal power plant that artificially creates the much-needed porosity within the earth to allow water to flow from an injection well to the production well. This is done by pumping cold water into the hot, solid rock, causing the rock to crack because of thermal contraction and water vapor pressure. Now, before you shout out in the comments talking about how this is just like fracking, know that EGS only pumps water, so there's no risk of groundwater contamination like there is with natural gas and oil. And this also happens at much lower pressure, so there's much lower risk to the site's geological stability. Still, the slight risk of geological instability is the trade-off of having access to geothermal energy anywhere, which is huge. There are several EGS plants already in commercial operation, with France's Schultz plant and Germany's Landau plant being the first. So at this point, if you're unconvinced about the prospects of EGS, well, good news. There's another alternative that I think is actually more appealing. An Alberta-based technology company called Evor designed the perfect solution for geothermal. Their advanced geothermal system, or you guessed it, AGS, basically works by connecting the injection well to the production well through a sealed pipe, completely eliminating the need for fractured rock. There's also absolutely no greenhouse gas emissions, no chance of underground water pollution, and we can even use liquids other than water to extract heat more efficiently, which is not an option for other geothermal systems. The first Evor loop was built in Canada as a proof of concept, and it was built in some of the toughest rock around, and has been in operation since 2019. However, this promising solution is yet to hit commercial scale. If it does, though, it could finally open the door to an endless supply of energy like we've never seen before. Speaking of which, there's an even newer technology right around the corner that could make geothermal even more promising. By allowing us to drill twice as deep and access temperatures as high as 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit, and get this, without even touching the rock. But that breakthrough is so promising that it's earned a video all its own. So stay tuned, we'll follow up shortly. If we can get this to work and lower the cost of geothermal energy down to the levels of current diesel and natural gas generators, we'll finally have a real candidate to replace fossil fuels on a global scale. And that's something worth looking forward to. And I'll leave you with one final thought. Like all these topics that we cover, there's always pros and cons and trade-offs. And I'm thinking there's gonna be a few comments about this. What happens if we take too much heat out of the core or the earth? And if the earth cools, that introduces a whole slew of other problems. What it comes down to, though, is the scale of what we'd be looking at. If there were bajillions of these geothermal power plants all around the world, that might be a concern. But by and large, based on where they're built and how feasible they are, odds are we don't have to worry about the earth cooling anytime soon. But I want to hear your thoughts on this. Do you think technologies like enhanced geothermal are simple or too risky to pursue? Do you think advanced geothermal like Evor's solution will be the holy grail of clean, safe, sustainable, and reliable energy production? Sound off in the comments below. But before you go, check out this video that we did on geothermal that I think you'll also enjoy. See you next week.